They say it's possible to have too much of a good thing, but when we look at Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse, we just don't think that's true. There are so many comic book and cultural references, along with breathtaking animation and interesting characters, it's hard to keep up. But don't worry, because we'll break it down and share some things you might miss if you blink during the movie. But before we swing, see what we did there? And let you know of everything you need to pay attention to, subscribe to CBR and ring that bell to join our notification squad so you never miss any of our MCU videos. Donald Glover. We're going to talk about the secret identity of Donald Glover, and don't worry, we're not talking about Childish Gambino. Although, come to think of it, have you ever seen those two in the same room? When The Amazing Spider-Man was in the works, some fans apparently decided Glover would be the perfect fit for the role, and the hashtag Donald4Spider-Man was launched. Although it was trending, it turns out that's not how casting directors make their choices. The role went to Andrew Garfield, but fans just couldn't forget the idea of Glover playing Peter Parker. However, this doesn't mean Glover wasn't caught up in the web of the Spider-Verse. Glover went on to voice Miles Morales in the Ultimate Spider-Man cartoon, and he appeared in Spider-Man Homecoming, where he mentioned having a nephew in the neighborhood, making him Aaron Davis, the uncle of Miles Morales. The voice actor lending his talent to Miles in Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse is Shameik Moore, but don't think we won't get to see any references to Glover in the movie. Keep a close eye on some of the background characters and see if you can spot one who looks suspiciously like Donald Glover. The resemblance is way too close to be unintentional, and it's confirmed there will be some references to Glover in the movie. Community. Donald Glover is one star you don't want to sleep on, because we aren't sure if he ever gets any sleep himself. He's been putting out content and taking on roles for ages, but one of his best-known works is the show Community. He played the part of former football star Troy Barnes, and the show went on to earn critical acclaim and no shortage of fans. Well, if you're a Community fan, you're in good company. Producer and co-writer Phil Lord and producer Chris Miller have revealed that they're fans of the hit show and believe that it has a place in the Spider-Verse. When asked about the Donald Glover cameo, Lord and Miller revealed that it wasn't just the actor they were trying to pay tribute to. They wanted to tip their hat to the show Community as well. So if you're watching Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse and can't stop thinking about Community, there's a reason. Donald Glover is way more than just a guy who once wanted to play Spider-Man in a movie. Writer Michael Brian Bendis, who created the character of Miles Morales, admits that Glover was among his inspirations for the character. Occasionally, good things do come from Twitter hashtags, and apparently, the character of Miles Morales is one of them. Peter Parker. Obviously, we're so excited to see all new versions of our beloved Spider-Man, but that doesn't mean we've forgotten about Peter Parker. Luckily, we'll get a chance to see Peter in Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse, but there's just one question: which Peter Parker? There are multiple versions of Spider-Man, but there are also multiple Peter Parkers. Even just in the movies, Tobey Maguire, Andrew Garfield, and Tom Holland have all played different versions of this iconic comic book character, but the Into the Spider-Verse Peter will be one who's familiar to movie fans and one we haven't seen in a very long time. Spider-Man, directed by Sam Raimi, was a huge hit and helped launch the craze of superhero movies, and that's the version we can look forward to seeing during Into the Spider-Verse. Although things went a little bit off the rails by Spider-Man 3, there's no denying this series has tons of iconic moments, many of which we'll see snippets of in the latest movie. As Peter talks to Miles, we see flashes of famous scenes from the movies, including a car soaring through a restaurant window, Spider-Man trying to stop a speeding train, being hunted by Dr. Octopus, and of course, that iconic upside-down kiss with Mary Jane. Wow, are we the only ones feeling nostalgic right now? Video games. We don't think there's ever a bad time to be a Spider-Man fan, but now might be an especially good time. In addition to the comics and the movies, there's the awesome Spider-Man video game for PS4, which on its own is chock full of awesome Easter eggs. But if you're a fan of that game, a lot of things in Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse are going to look awfully familiar to you. One of the many fun parts of the game is all of the different spider suits, and we see a version of the advanced suit in the movie. Just over Aunt May's shoulder, you can see the trademark white design. If you've had the chance to play the Spider-Man video game, and if you haven't, you should, you'll see a ton of suits that look familiar in the Spider-Verse, perhaps the most notable of which is the Spider-Man noir costume worn by the character voiced by Nicolas Cage. This version of Peter Parker became Spider-Man during the Great Depression in the 30s and fights against crime boss Norman Osborn, better known as the Green Goblin. If you've been eagerly devouring any and all news related to Spider-Man Far From Home, you might recognize this suit. We spotted Tom Holland wearing it while filming Far From Home. Villains. There are tons of great villains in Spider-Man's rogue gallery, and movie audiences are already familiar with many of them. Of course, we all know about Dr. Octopus and the Green Goblin, but we'll be seeing tons of new villains in Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse. We'll see some signs of the insidious Alchemax Corporation, which essentially rules the world in the future. Alchemax always has a keen interest in time travel and other dimensions, so their involvement in the Spider-Verse is incredibly fitting. We also have the ultimate version of Scorpion, who's a ruthless, power-hungry mob boss. In the comics, he was the first supervillain Miles Morales ever faced, so it makes sense that he shows up in the Spider-Verse, and then there's Tombstone, the formidable and nearly indestructible nemesis of Miles Morales. In the comic books, he has Kingpin's back, but this time he's on Scorpion's side. When we're introduced to Spider-Pig, it's easy to get distracted because, well, it's Spider-Pig, but he also shows off a ton of villains. Of course, we have the big baddies like Kingpin, but there's also Nightwatch, Hammerhead, and the Rose. With so many different versions of Spider-Man, it makes sense that we'll see more villains than we know what to do with. Chance the Rapper. Childish Gambino isn't the only musical artist to be honored with a small part in Spider-Man Enter the Spider-Verse. Chance the Rapper has received no shortage of accolades for his music, and he's also received what we consider to be the ultimate honor, being featured in a comic book. That's right, Chance the Rapper was mentioned in an issue of Marvel's Spider-Man. Talk about a shout-out! Tom Holland's Spider-Man may be quick with the snappy pop culture references, but this version is apparently a little behind. He says, "I'm young and hip, ask me any question about Chance the Rapper." Sorry, Spidey, but if you have to say you're young and hip, you're probably not. Apparently, Chance the Rapper is still cool in the Spider-Verse as well. When our heroes are visiting a young Miles Morales dormitory, you can see a poster for the mixtape Coloring Book by Chance the Rapper. On the actual cover art for Coloring Book, he wears a 3 on his hat to signify it's his third mixtape, but in the movie poster, he's wearing a 4 on his hat. Having one more mixtape from Chance the Rapper than we actually do definitely makes this dimension appear more futuristic. It looks like the Miles Morales Spider-Man is actually both young and hip. What if? There are so many great laugh-out-loud moments in Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse that it's hard to pick out all of the little details, but don't worry, we'll take care of that part for you. Remember when all of the Spider-Men and Spider-Pig are squished together on the ceiling to avoid detection? They are hard to miss, so it might have been easy to forget about the comic book featured in this scene, so let's take a closer look. The book is called Imagine That, There Was More Than One Spider-Man. Now, how crazy would that be, especially if they were all in a movie together? Now, of course, this is a nod to the movie we're watching, but there's a real Marvel comic book series called What If? This series featured a wide variety of hypothetical scenarios involving various Marvel characters. They're simple one-shot storylines, but darn if they aren't compelling. Marvel comic fans know there are tons of parallel versions of Earth, and these books explore ideas such as, what if Spider-Man had joined the Fantastic Four? What if Aunt May had died instead of Uncle Ben? Or what if Venom possessed Deadpool? Actually, we wouldn't mind watching a movie about that one. We might be adding that one to our Marvel movie lineup wishlist. Christmas album. During the winter, there are a variety of holidays which take place, but here at CBR, we don't want you to forget the true reason for the season, Spider-Man. That's right, though the roads may be icy, our friendly neighborhood Spider-Man doesn't exactly get vacation time. In addition to swinging through the streets and fighting crimes, it appears he's had to release an album of Christmas songs during Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse. Peter Parker lists his various accomplishments, and while vanquishing villains and saving the day is cool and all, we can't just gloss over the release of his Christmas album. We get to see some of the tracks on this album, and believe us, you want it in your Christmas stocking. It includes such wonderful holiday classics as Spidey, It's Cold Outside, Spidey the Snowman, and It's Beginning to Look a Lot Like Non-Denominational Holiday. While we love those, We think these passive-aggressive offerings capture the true spirit of Christmas. Silent night, you're welcome, and joy to the world that I just saved. Our sad bank accounts know that there's a ton of Spider-Man merchandise out there already, but this would definitely be the prize of our collection. Forget Chance the Rapper. The Spider-Man Christmas album is clearly the pinnacle of music. Joe Perry. The Guardians of the Galaxy franchise gets a lot of credit for its fantastic music, but we don't think Spider-Man is any slouch in that department either, and no, we're not just talking about the Spider-Man Christmas album. Joe Perry is the lead guitarist of a little band you might have heard of called Aerosmith. He performed the opening theme to the TV show Spider-Man: The Animated Series. In the episode The Alien Costume Part 1, Peter Parker discovered the alien symbiote could turn into street clothes. He then made the symbiote appear like clothes worn by that guy from Aerosmith in reference to Joe Perry. And this wasn't just a one-off reference. Aerosmith even did a cover of the 1967 Spider-Man theme for the 2002 Spider-Man movie starring Tobey Maguire. It seems like Joe Perry is way more than just that guy from Aerosmith as far as Spider-Man is concerned, so of course, we weren't surprised to see a shout out to him during Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse. Did you catch it, or did you happen to blink? When Miles Morales is swinging through the air, he flies right past a massive neon sign reading, Perry Joe. In an alternate dimension, could Chance the Rapper have four mixtapes and Joe Perry's name be Perry Joe? What'll they come up with next? Kirby Krackle. Everyone knows the late, great Stan Lee was the face of Marvel Comics and the master of comic book movie cameos, but he wasn't alone in creating his iconic characters. Jack Kirby co-created some of our favorite heroes, including the Incredible Hulk, the X-Men, and the Fantastic Four. Although Steve Ditko is credited with co-creating Spider-Man along with Stan Lee, Kirby was the one who drew the very first Spider-Man comic book cover. His drawing style was so unique that one particular technique came to be known as the Kirby Krackle or Kirby Dots. If you've ever picked up a comic book, you've probably seen these, even if you didn't know what they were called. It's when space is filled with black and covered in pseudo-fractal images to represent negative space and types of energy. This can be anything from the blast from a ray gun to an explosion in Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse. We see our heroes encountering a device used to break through the barrier separating dimensions. When the device powers up, it surges with energy, which looks remarkably like the Kirby Krackle we grew up seeing on the pages of Marvel Comics. Of course, now that we've pointed this effect out, we have a feeling you'll be noticing it absolutely everywhere. What are you most excited to see in Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse, or is there something that they left out that you wanted to be included? Share your thoughts with us in the comments section below, and then click on the subscribe button for more MCU videos from CBR. Thanks for watching.